Okay. Hi, everyone. Thank you for tuning in. And also thank you to Michelle for moderating. I'm Tanu Kumar. I'm a PhD candidate in the political science department at UC Berkeley. And I'm going to be talking to you about the what I call the human capital effects of subsidizing housing. And this is work that's based in Mumbai, India. Okay. So as many of you know, subsidizing housing is a super common policy all over the world. Governments do this everywhere. Policies that we might be more familiar with in the US are mortgage subsidies, but in a lot of countries, we also see home price subsidies. And what I'm referring to here is basically government constructed housing that's sold at a super low price. And you know, these policies, they get a lot less academic interest than cash transfers maybe, but we can really think of them as wealth transfers to beneficiaries. And you can experience these wealth transfers in sort of any combination of three payout structures. One is sort of a stream of in-kind benefits for people who actually choose to move into the homes. A lot of times people will buy a house, but they won't move into it, but they'll just rent it out. And so you also get some stream of, you can also get some stream of cash benefits instead. And then also, you know, eventually you can resell the house and get the benefit of the subsidy through resale. If you're living in an urban area, the actual benefits that you get might be much larger than the subsidy because the value of your home will probably increase over time. And actually a lot of research in the United States finds that homes are sort of an asset that really forms the cornerstone of wealth accumulation for a lot of families. And actually there's been a lot of new research from the United States that finds that racial disparity in access to subsidies and also just housing in general can really account for a lot of disparities in wealth over time. So I ask, what are the effects of these subsidies actually on human capital? And what I'm really interested in is educational attainment and family decision-making. And so I think it's really important to understand these effects on human capital to fully understand long-term effects on economic trajectories. If I'm investing in education, then I'll probably earn more over my lifetime. So there are some studies that look at this in the US using some sort of like matching and IV strategies, but of course they all suffer from this problem of selection on observables. And we also don't really see that much study of subsidized housing policies in low and middle income countries where these policies are pretty prevalent. And so what I do in this paper is I study home price subsidies in India. And what's really common in India is this policy of creating government construction homes and selling them at a very heavily subsidized price. And this is a program that's common in India, in all cities in India, but also we see it in a lot of other countries as well. We see it in Brazil, in Ethiopia, Uruguay, Kenya, South Africa. It's a really, really common program. And in India, this is a program that's been around since the 1950s, but it's actually getting a lot more interest in recent years because the government really recently announced a program in 2015 that's aiming to build 20 million new subsidized homes by 2022. I'm not quite sure how successful they've been in that attempt, but it's getting a lot more attention in recent years. And so the program that I study is a lottery conducted by a state level agency in 2012 and 2014. This is actually a lottery that occurs every year, but I looked at 2 years in particular. We can talk about why in the Q&A if anyone's curious. And obviously the randomized selection through the lottery, it really allows us to identify the effects of this program among applicants. And as we'll see, the subsidy in this program is quite large. It's between $10,000 to $45,000, which for low and middle income households in India is a huge amount of money. And but of course, these houses aren't given out to people for free. They have to pay a 15-year mortgage. And so we end up seeing that this policy doesn't really affect the poorest people living in a city, but it's more of a lower middle class intervention because these are the people who can actually afford to participate in the intervention. In the study, they're not allowed to resell the home. Well, in the policy, people aren't allowed to resell the home for 10 years, which is within the time period of the study. They also don't pay any property tax for 10 years. People are, however, allowed to put the homes up for rent, and 50% of the households in my sample actually don't move into the homes, but just put them up for rent. These pictures just sort of give you an idea of what this housing looks like. It's very dense housing. This is an example of an apartment building. You have hundreds of units in each of these buildings. And also, you know, they're very clearly identifiable as public housing. They have the stamp of the agency all over them. And so it's generally moderate quality housing. Most people will get about a room or two rooms and you know, their own private bathrooms or private sinks, but we can talk about that in a little bit. And so these are the lotteries that are included in the study. Again, there are multiple lotteries from 2012 and 2014. And we can see a few things here. First of all, again, these are small apartments. They're between 270 and about 450 square feet. So there's not a lot of room in them. And what we can also see is that the subsidies are quite large. If you look at the allotment, the difference between the allotment price and what these homes would have sold for in 2017, again, some of these homes are sold at like 30% of the actual selling price. And this map will give you an idea of where these homes are in Mumbai. The blue dots are the locations of the apartment buildings included in the study, and the red dots are the locations of the respondents at the time that they applied. A few things to note here is that it looks like the apartments are really on the outskirts of the city, but these are still pretty dense areas. We can think of the southern part of Mumbai right here as maybe like downtown, but these are very densely occupied suburban areas over here. And also all of the apartment buildings are really squarely on major transit lines and train lines. So keep these red dots in mind. They're spread out all over the city because this was a data collection project. What I did was we did an in-person household survey of 500 each winners and non-winners of these lotteries in 2017. So what I did was from the state agency, I collected a list of contact information for winners and applicants of these lotteries and tried to track them down. And this was I worked with a local NGO, and over a period of 9 months, knocked on a bunch of doors and tried to find all of these people. And so eventually we ended up contacting about 84% of the original sampling frame. And you see, we have like a roughly similar number of non-winners and winners in the eventual group of people that we ended up contacting. And the balance tests aren't in the presentation, but we can talk about them. We see that I find that the group of non-winners and winners that I ended up contacting are roughly similar on a lot of fixed characteristics like religion, caste, and length of time in Mumbai. So just a note on what this population looks like before we get into the results. As I said before, these households, these are really lower middle class households. They're not all that poor, but they're also not particularly wealthy either. Most of them have permanent roofs, so they're not really living in slums. We're not thinking of the households with metal or plastic or thatched roofs. They actually live in permanent housing. Most of the control group also has private taps and private toilets, so a lot of the people aren't really living in this cheap housing that we think of in lots of parts of Mumbai where people are sharing public services. They are by law not allowed to, applicants are not allowed to own, legally own any housing in the state. So most of the people actually report renting or living in joint families, which is basically I'm living in a household with my parents or my grandparents and my aunts and uncles. They do tend to be fairly educated. Most of them have between 10 to 11 years of education. So people are moving through high school. They're not necessarily completing high school and really generally not going on to college. And at the same time, we don't really see that many people working formal jobs. Most of the respondents report working private sector informal jobs. So, and what I mean by formal is you have some type of pension or you have some type of contract for your job. So just a few notes on the estimation before we get into the results. I look at household level and individual effects as estimated through a pre-specified linear regression. For individual results, errors are clustered at the household level. What we're really looking at is an ITT analysis. A lot of people do not, well, not a lot, about 8% of the treated units don't actually take up the housing, but just ignoring that for now. And HCT standard errors, and I also do a multiple testing procedure that I'll show you in a second. So yeah, let's get into the results. Just a note on the presentation, on the right, you'll see the p-values with the p-values adjusted for multiple testing in parentheses. And so if we look at individual level variables, we see about a 0.13 standard deviation effect on years of education. And to interpret that, that's about a half year of education. And so what we can see this intervention doing is it's moving treatment group individuals from the 61st to the 63rd percentile of education in the country. We also see about a 4% treatment effect on people reporting that they're working. And if we look into the results, we really see that this is an effect on people saying that they're working full-time as opposed to working part-time. At the household level, nothing really to note, but the main thing is that parents are reporting that they're sending their children to public school as opposed to private school less often. So to sort of make sense of what's going on with the education effects here, I find it useful to look at the distribution of education for the full sample. So what we can see is that this is a multimodal distribution. We can see that there are a lot of people have no years of education and a lot of people have 10 years of education. This makes sense in India because at 10th grade, you have to take a large board exam, which in itself is a certificate. We see another mode at 12 and we see another mode at 15. In India, a BA typically takes 3 years. And if we sort of break apart this distribution into the treatment and control, we see that treatment group members are more likely to finish high school and they're also more likely to finish college. And we can really see this happen, and we can sort of break this down by cohort. If we look at people who turned 16 after the lottery, we actually, among this cohort, there's a 14 percentage point treatment effect on people completing grade 10. And most of our action is really in this group down here, people who turned 21 after the lottery. And there's a 15 percentage point treatment effect among this group on completing, moving past grade 12 and completing college. So keep in mind that most of the action is really in this cohort here, the sort of older youth cohort. If we look at employment among this group, this is just a regression where the outcome is employment. And if we look at the interaction effects, we can see that for people who turn 21, you don't have a 4% percentage point treatment effect, but actually a 21.7 percentage point treatment effect on employment among this cohort of people. And again, this is really an effect on their being employed full-time as opposed to doing wage work or casual labor. So there are a few different mechanisms that might account for these effects. One is that, you know, people might just be moving to better neighborhoods and have better opportunities for education. Another might be that this intervention is, like I said, it's a wealth effect. It might change their budget constraints. They might have more money to spend in the future, or they might plan to have more or they might be changing their decision making because this wealth transfer is actually changing their time horizons. So I'm going to talk a little bit about the first and the third mechanisms quickly. We can see that we can actually look at treatment effects for the neighborhoods that people live in. And what's interesting is that we actually see negative treatment effects for the quality of schooling it for the zip codes that people are living in. And this makes sense if you think about it, because a lot of this lottery housing is sort of built in less desirable areas of the city. And so, you know, people are living in areas with a smaller percentage of senior secondary schools, a smaller percentage of schools with an office for the headmaster. Those are sort of a proxy for the size of the school, and fewer schools that are taught in English. So people aren't really moving to places with better schools. They're actually moving to places with worse schools, and we're still seeing this treatment effect. And then we can look a little bit at attitudes. This is a little bit small. I hope you can see it. What I see is that you know, people are, they're happier with their financial situations. They have, they believe that their children are going to have better lives than them. And they're sort of more sure that they're going to stay in Mumbai. And so what I'm arguing in this paper is that what this intervention is doing, it's actually lengthening people's time horizons and changing their decision-making in that way. And we also find that this intervention leads people to have slightly more individualistic attitudes. They're more likely to think that effort like leads to more success, which might also affect their decision-making and investment in human capital. So the broad takeaways that I'd sort of like everyone to leave with is that subsidizing housing is a really common policy all over the world, and it's a wealth transfer to middle-class households. And this wealth, it can further enable households to build human capital by investing in education. And also that also generates longer term employment outcomes. And because this is sort of a benefit to middle-class households, it might, in some places, this intervention might actually exacerbate inequalities. But this is, of course, it's a short-term study. It's a 3 to 5 year study. So we don't really know what the effects on younger children are. And so it'll be interesting to see longer term effects. Okay, thank you.
Great, thank you so much, Tanu. That was really interesting. Attendees, if you have any questions, again, you can just chat and I'll try to unmute you. In the meantime, I actually have a quick question. So you had mentioned, did you mention that some of the people ended up purchasing the homes and then ended up renting?
50%, yeah.
50%, that's pretty sizable. Did you take a look at the heterogeneity between winners that ended up renting versus the ones that ended up moving in?
Yeah, so we can really identify predictors of moving. So most of the time, people who ended up moving tended to be higher caste, people who ended up renting were higher caste and actually wealthier. But it's hard to look at treatment effects on, it's hard to look at these heterogeneous treatment effects because we don't really know among the control group who the renters and non-renters would be. So we don't have the appropriate comparison.
Great. Thank you. I have a question from Ketki. She said, do you know if people end up staying in locations longer? As in, winning the lottery also results in more stability in your housing, is less disruptive from just having to relocate. And then also a comment, I really like the belief result on effort resulting in success, which is hard to imagine. It's a wealth channel and is convincing that perhaps winning the lottery changed aspirations outside the wealth channel. So I think her question is, do you know if people end up staying in the location longer?
Yeah, that's something that we can, that would be interesting to look at in follow-up surveys. What we collected data on was people's reported intention of staying in a location longer, and people, you know, report being, saying that they'll stay in place longer, but I didn't actually collect data on how much they moved.
We have another question from Paul Novosad saying, great presentation. I'm wondering if the true value of these homes is much higher than the transaction value due to black money payments, in which case it's an even bigger wealth transfer than the suggested amount.
Okay, so basically people might be spending money, people might be paying more for this housing than suggested. It's possible. It's definitely possible. that would be something to look into. It's a good comment. All right, thank you.
I was curious if you have any information on housing expenditure that is being used by people on both sides. I'm kind of curious to what extent it seems like this is really relaxing credit constraints and that's allowing for the educational gains or you know, kind of what is it about the wealth? Is it like you needed it all at one point in time, or is it just like kind of like the stream of payments that's allowing you to kind of go to school, or that might help you kind of tie into some of the beliefs on that side too?
Yeah, so there are a few questions sort of packed in there, I believe. So for the people who are renting the housing out, they are actually getting a stream of payments. That stream of payments, once you consider it net of the mortgage they have to pay, it's not all that large. It's about $10 to $20 a month, which it's still nothing for sure. For the people who are not renting the homes out, we actually see a negative effect on the stream of income because they have to pay these mortgages over time. In terms of effects on spending on housing expenditure, I measured physical asset ownership, not housing expenditure, which might get at your question in the same way. We don't really see any effects on ownerships of things like TVs, bikes, motorcycles, or anything. So I didn't really detect that people were spending money on other things, which was interesting to me. And I don't believe that this intervention is actually really relaxing credit constraints in any way, because people aren't really borrowing on this asset because you can't because it's a loan that they, right.
We have a question from Raisa. Raisa Sara said, really nice paper. I wonder when you collected the data, if you mentioned about affiliation with the housing lottery program and if that may influence the reported aspirations and beliefs. That's a good question.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. When we did the survey, we presented ourselves as independent researchers who are not at all affiliated with the agency. But of course, you know, people can believe whatever they want to believe. You'd have to think through why that those beliefs or why that effect might be strong, more prevalent for the winners as opposed to the non-winners. And so that would be something to think through. But we did try to stress that we were independent researchers.